The views and opinions expressed in this program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of BronxNet or the program underwriters.
Welcome to Public Health America, a 30-minute program on BronxNet where we talk with national experts to promote health and social justice. I'm your host, Dr. William Latimer. We begin by focusing on a current health topic from the COVID pandemic to cardiovascular disease. Our goal is to provide you with not only the best science, but practical tips to live a healthier life. On Public Health America, we also celebrate what studies have long documented, namely the unparalleled value of a college education by setting the stage to pursue a career of your choice, increase lifetime earnings and opportunity, and champion the ability to engage in civil debate. But for many, finding a path to college is neither clear nor certain. What if you're a high school student with supportive parents but feel daunted by the prospect of being the first in your family to attend college? What if you're a single mother or father and want to attend college but have no childcare? On Public Health America, our expert will also talk about decisions they made and support they received that helped them beat the odds. By sharing one or two life lessons, their stories may provide you with the inspiration and method to realize your dreams. This is Public Health America. Welcome to Public Health America. I'm your host, Dr. William Latimer. It's a pleasure to have Dr. Padmini Murthy, Professor of Global Health Director at New York Medical College School of Health Sciences and Practice, Global Health Lead of the American Medical Women's Association. Padmini, welcome.
Thank you so much for having me on the show.
Pleasure to have you. So I know you've been doing some cutting edge work on the intersection of global health and human rights, particularly as it pertains to the health status of women and girls. Tell us a little bit about your work.
Thank you so much. I'm not saying this because I'm a woman or the mother of a daughter, but unfortunately, women and girls everywhere around the world have been shortchanged, especially when it comes to their health and well-being. As we know, in so many places, they can't even make choices whether it's to space their children or to go to school or to delay their age of marriage. So one of the things I found when I was a young girl growing up in India many years ago, that I always used to ask these questions, why? When I used to see some of the others, they didn't have the same freedom I had and my sister had. And then I realized that it's the way we think, the way we are brought up. So to me, health is important. Not only do I say that as a physician, a public health professional, but also because this is, without health, you don't have anything. And somebody can only experience their full health potential when their human rights are very much intertwined into the access to health, the delivery of healthcare services. So that's why it's important.
So would you say the lion's share of your work is in the US or international or both?
I would say it's both. For example, during the current COVID crisis, I just want to give you a very brief example with the American Medical Women, where I'm the global health lead. It's an NGO which is over 105 years old. I'm not 105, but we've been around for a long time, and we work on the intersection of health and human rights. And we worked with faith-based NGOs and made sure we delivered food from here to the sisters of charity, Mother Teresa's Foundation in India, because they reached out to us. So what I'm saying is this was global efforts with global outreach and local efforts with a global outreach. And it was partnering. When we look at the Sustainable Development Goals, there's 17 of them. So this is 17, which really talks about partnerships to promote health and well-being for all. And the majority of the people suffering there when the sisters reached out to us were women and girls. So to answer your question in one sentence, it is both in the US and outside the US. I just gave you an example of outside the US.
As you outline your mission, obviously it's critically important and fairly far reaching given that there are so many countries throughout the world that human rights issues, particularly as they relate to women and girls, is greatly troublesome. And then certainly in the US, there are all kinds of issues related to gender and sex and that still need to be sorted out that are not, and all kinds of, you know, one could argue rights that are potentially being eroded. How do you choose what issues, what countries, what topics to focus on? Because it just seems to me that there could be so much to do. How do you select? And you know, if you could give another example or two of your work, I think it would be very instructive.
The way I select is what is burning and what is something I feel passionately about. I feel very passionately about making sure whatever I can do along with my other colleagues and friends to address the health needs, the basic health needs of women and girls. And how do we choose? Now, we all know that there is a lot of what we call period poverty, where women and girls in the US and outside do not have access to the sanitary products they need. So currently, I am working along with my colleagues, and we've galvanized a lot of students with the First Lady of Suriname, Her Excellency's office, to address a period poverty while keeping in lieu with the sustainability on how to make sure we can get to them. This is a pilot project of reusable sanitary products. So we have a lot of people. We also working with another NGO, Days for Girls, where we have teams of volunteers sewing these sanitary pads, which can be reused by washing them, which we send overseas. This might seem something trivial, but we all need to know, not only in a country like Suriname, even here, we have a lot of period poverty, especially for those of our, you know, of the women who are incarcerated in prisons. And this is terrible that we have to pay a tax on sanitary products, which is considered a luxury good, when in actually it is an essential product. So in answer to your question, these are issues where we can all work together simply to get together, because there's power in numbers, and it's small drops of water make a mighty ocean. That's what we need in public health. So I hope I've answered your question by giving you a small example.
No, that's a great example, and you certainly have. So in my experience, typically, I'm thinking of USAID, CFAR, other mechanisms that fund intervention projects, not so much research, large scale, like the ones you're describing, in one instance to provide sanitary products to, a country that seems unbelievably important. Do you have the ability to take a moment? And believe me, if you don't, it's not a criticism. Do you have the ability to take a moment and figure out what works? Or is it that, you're just so busy with the day-to-day of dealing with the fires that you're putting out that it's more about just getting, being responsive to the needs? Was that clear?
It was very clear. And in answer to your question is, with the whole point of having projects, whether it was sending food to the Sisters of Charity in Calcutta to help the people who are socially disadvantaged, or to address period poverty, as I stressed clearly, Bill, this was a pilot project. So we are going to make sure we even anticipate in part phase two, how to have training for where women are able there to sew sanitary pads, because the whole crux of it is sustainability. I mean, you cannot keep supplying bread to somebody for the rest of your life and their lives, but it is to teach them how to bake bread well so that it caters to their needs. So this is what I want to really stress, that's why it's so important. And that's why I always have my students involved, young people involved, and my daughter's also involved in this. So are some of our other friends, to see what can we do to teach them to be self-sufficient? So I think the advantage of these is we are bringing together communities, through local efforts, as I said, to really have an impact. And again, to make them understand that these are simple things they can follow and make sure that they can be self-sufficient.
So clearly you are working at a structural level to make these great interventions you're doing sustainable by partnering with, you know, boots on the ground, folks in the various communities in which you're working. We just have a couple minutes left. Tell us about what are you working on now and what are the next steps?
Okay, so what I'm working on now is, as I said, this is one of the things to address poverty. And the other thing, coming back to the U.S., you know, the Black Maternal Momnibus Act of 2021 was introduced in February this year. And one of the things from UNA USA, we are working to see how can we promote this. So that's something to address these discrepancies in maternal health care. So that's the whole thing we are also working on. So these two are on the top of my agenda.
That's great. So we're going to take a quick break. When we return, Dr. Murthy will tell us a little bit about her life story and how her post-secondary education experience at the table for this amazing career in advocacy and supporting the health of women and girls. This is Public Health America. I'm your host, Dr. William Latimer. We'll be right back.
A media network for you.
BronxNet TV.
Come learn in your new state-of-the-art studios at Lehman College.
At Mercy College.
And coming soon to the South Bronx in the Hub.
Inspire with your stories, culture, history.
Your Bronx on BronxNet.
Engage with us.
Connect with us at your channels and at BronxNet.tv.
Learn, engage, inspire. BronxNet TV.
From the Bronx
to the world.
BronxNet.
Welcome back to Public Health America. I'm your host, Dr. William Latimer. So Padmini, on this segment of the program, I always open with the same question. Where were you born? And tell us about some of your formative experiences.
Thank you so much, Bill. So, I was born in India. And I did a lot of my education in India, and then lived outside now for the more than 30 years, was in the United Kingdom, in the Middle East, and in the US for 27 years. And growing up, I had a very interesting childhood because my parents, always made sure we were exposed, my sister and I, to people from different countries, different, diverse cultures. And they had this huge big house where they used to host students, especially when they came to India from overseas. I remember we had Japanese students, we had Swiss students who used to come. You know, backpacking was common in the 80s when I was growing up, like late 70s and 80s. And they used to come and stay with us because they used to save money. And this is what I was exposed to, like multilateralism, multiculturalism, if that's a word, I just coined it. And to say that people are, you know, they may look different from you, but we're all same. And the other thing I wanted to share, what really set me going, like, being an activist, I guess I was born with an activist gene. Maybe I inherited that from my mother, because when we were kids growing up, you know, we used to have a lot of domestic help in the house. And I remember there used to be many young people who kind of used to fight to say, we want to come and work with your mom. And one day I asked them, and I asked my mom, I said, Mom, why does everybody want to come and work for you? She said, because, and then she said, ask one of the girls. So I asked one of the girls whom my mom also taught English and, you know, taught her to go to school part-time. She stayed with us for a long time. And I remember my parents paid her school fees to go to school. Long story short, she said, because your mother buys us sanitary products, what she buys for you and your sister. And that got me to thinking. I go, like, so there are people who don't have access to the basic needs we have. So that is what. So since maybe I was 11 years old, that's like such a long time ago. So that got me thinking. I said, like, okay, I am fortunate in having something, so I need to spread this around or see what can I do. So my mantra is, like, when I tell students or anybody I speak to, it's, you don't have to be a billionaire or a millionaire. Whatever you can do, you can do to help others. So advocacy needs to be practical. It needs to be steadfast. And advocacy is not necessarily protesting something, but working to see how these can be addressed. So fast forward, after living in all these countries, and then I came to the US, I did my training again. I went to NYU, and then I have a master's in public health, and I have a master's in management. And for me, I was always conscious of social determinants. And one thing I always learned from my late mom, she always used to say, one thing nobody can steal from you, they can steal your money, they can steal your jewelry or your car, anything, but they cannot steal your education and skill set. So that's why, to me, investing in education is so important, because it helps you not only maybe get a few letters next to your name, but also gives you the skill sets on how you can do something, not only to make a difference for yourself, but for others, and you can be strong. Back to you, Bill. Thank you.
Yeah, what a wonderful childhood, adolescence you had in India, being given the opportunity to meet so many amazing people from around the world. Where did you do your initial post-secondary, what we call undergraduate education?
That was in India. Yes. Yep. Right. My pre-med and med. Yes. And then went to England, then trained there, and then, came here to the US. So yes.
Great. So talk to us a little bit about the post-secondary education system in India. What's that like? How's it different from the US? How's it similar? Or just any comments you want to share?
Thank you. So the post-secondary education is a little different in that after grade 12, that you do 10 years in school, and then you do 2 years in what is called an intermediary, or you do 12 years in school. And then you go to a undergrad. Well, that can be anything you choose. Like, you know, you can go directly to medical school, which is 5.5 years, or you go to do your engineering or architecture, or you do 3 years of undergrad. The basic difference, Bill, is here our undergrad is 4 years in the US. In India, it's 3 years. And then a lot of people like me, I did like my pre-medicine, like my bachelor's in science, and then went on to medical school, which was like 5.5 years. And my sister, who did her engineering, she went directly from plus two. There are other people who do their 3 years of undergrad and then go on to law school. It's pretty competitive. You have to pass an exam. Like we have the GRE here. You pass what is an entrance exam. You pass that, you get into medical school or engineering school. And then there are some other schools, at least there were, where they looked at your performance in high school, and then you would get a seat to study there. So again, it's competitive. And you know what? It's like they have now, I think they have all these, when I speak to people back in India, they have all these coaching centers. Like we have the various coaching centers here to prepare you for your board certification. The same thing they have in India. So I think the differences are in the duration of the years, but the similarities is that you have to achieve something. You need to get a certain score. Like here we have the LSAT, and then you have your MCATs, where, you know, my medical students take the MCATs before coming to medical school. So the same way you have these different qualifying exams in quotes. But again, there is no shortcut to hard work. And I think whether it's a student in India or a student in the US or anywhere else, they do what they have to do.
Got it. Talk just one more minute or moment about your experience in India. Were there, you know, we've had other guests that have talked about the importance of doing what you love, the importance of having a mentor, the importance of experiential learning, in terms of sort of leveraging or utilizing that undergraduate, you know, or initial post-secondary experience as much as possible to sort of figure out the next steps. What was your experience in India, and what was one barrier you faced, if you faced any, and what was something that was protective or helpful?
Thank you. I hate to say it, that I didn't face any barriers, unfortunately, because I guess I was very lucky to have very supportive parents. And also I had a great mentor in medical school who saw my, my passion for social work or public service. And he encouraged me and to speak, like, you know, made sure I was like, you know, because he termed what I was a motivational speaker to. So go and speak to not only my peers, but other students, be in debating. So I had that. But one thing I would like to say is, if you don't ask somebody, you need to seek out. This is my advice to students everywhere. It doesn't matter whether you're in the Bronx, in Westchester, in Dutchess County, where I live, Westchester, where I teach, anywhere, you need to ask somebody, please, can you help me? And if you put it politely and nicely, people do help you. They meet you. So I've been a mentor to so many, and I've had some great mentors even here, you know, Dr. Keswani, whom I call my second mom. She is like 86 years old, 87, God bless her. She's been an amazing mentor to me in so many ways. And so many of us, we all need mentors, and we need to give back. And the relationship between a mentor and mentee is so sacred, because it's just not the mentor giving. Everybody has equal responsibilities and accountability. It doesn't change where you are, which country you are, which continent you're on.
So a real emphasis on the incredible power of a benevolent and helpful and strategic mentor. About a minute or so left. Once you got to the US, did you do a residency, or did you do the MPH, and if so, how did that go?
Well, I passed my boards and I redid my training, but I did my MPH and a master's in management from New York University. And I realized that my passion is teaching and, you know, like helping others. So that's where I kind of digressed a little. I still do teach, you know, medical students and other students in so many parts of the world. But to me, my passion is to make sure, like, you know, you build a team, because you make sure that the torch bearers whom you hand off your torch to understand how medicine, the practice of medicine or public health, is just not facts and figures. It's actually talking to people. Thank you.
That's great. So with just a few 30 or so seconds left, if you were to give a question I also often ask toward the end of the program, if you were to give one piece of advice to a young person in the Bronx or a non-traditional age person in the Bronx in terms of going to college, of, whether they should consider college and how to succeed, what would that be?
Thank you. One sentence: believe in yourself, invest in yourself. Education is the best. There's no shortcut. It might seem hard. It's worth it down the road. You're doing it for yourself. So please think of going to school, and you will realize how many doors and windows it opens for you. Thank you.
That's fantastic. I want to thank Dr. Murthy for joining us today. I want to thank our viewers for tuning in. I'm your host, Dr. William Latimer. This is Public Health America. See you next time. Take care. We'll be right back.